Hello.
Hello, everyone. I'm your host, Matt, a.k.a. Legion X, and welcome to another episode of The Gap, the generic anime podcast, where we talk about whether or not Kratos is actually a cocaine user or not. With me, I have my equally as high co-host, Shane. How are you doing today, Shane?
Hey, how's it going, everybody?
I told you not to do that into the mic, and you did it anyway.
I can't believe you've done this.
Oh, fuck. I can't believe
you've done this. Now the waveform is going to be ruined.
It's fine. Just don't listen with headphones.
Now the entire dot waveform is going to be ruined.
With me, I also have my co-host, Spencer. How are you doing today, Spencer?
Man, I'm sad that a movie like this is never going to be made. Shout out to Madhouse and the entire Japanese public for ruining the future of this division. So, you know.
I mean, Madhouse actually had faith in it. It's the Japanese public.
Yeah.
It's the Japanese that are stupid.
But I just want, listen, I'm shouting out Madhouse because they did a good job. I'm shouting out the Japanese public because, once again, they ruined something cool.
Then why are you shouting them out? You're supposed to be calling them out.
No. Sometimes I can actually shout out. I'm tired.
Hi, welcome to The Gap.
Welcome to The Gap. I am your host. We have a wonderful show for you today. We got some simulcast stuff to talk about. We have news. And, of course, we have our featured anime of the podcast, which is the first movie we're talking about. Was the first singular film, at least, we're talking about on the podcast, and that's Redline. Hope you're very excited for that. But first, we have the final installment in a series that's been going on the past couple of weeks, and that is Shane's One Piece catch-up journey. This is the final, and we have our final installment because guess who actually caught up on One Piece?
It's me.
So Shane, you watched it was pretty much just whole cake.
It was mostly whole cake.
Yeah, from the last time we caught up with you, and whole cake is excellent.
Whole cake is amazing.
so good. It's probably
one of my second favorite arc in the entire series, next to Marineford.
Really?
Yeah.
It's my top three for sure. It's in my top three.
You're just downing cereal over here.
I am. I have food with me. I'm hungry. But yeah, it's in my top. I mean, it is whole cake. So, and there's a milk guy. So
Sorry, what?
There's a milk guy, dude.
Yo, is this where Soul King? Brooke comes in.
Oh, yeah. This is where Soul King single-handedly takes on Big Mom and lives. I don't think people understand that fucking Brooke took on Big Mom and actually lived.
Like, head-to-head and survived.
This man can take people's souls via tasty-ass jams.
Oh, yeah. He puts out a slick riff. And he extracts the souls from their bodies.
This man is able to use his devil fruit in a way that he turns his rapier into ice and frees people.
Yeah.
It is the coolest thing you have ever seen.
Also,
and also remember, his rapier is also his cane that he carries. Yes. So.
And he is also a dandy gentleman, politely asks people to see their panties.
Every single female.
But he's at least polite about it.
He's polite about it. He's not like Sanji, so.
No.
He's polite about it, and if they say no, he's like, very well, ma'am, and then he never asks them again.
Usually ends up with Nami cracking him upside the head, and then he's like, well, now I'm sad.
I love Brooke! By the way, is probably my favorite in whole cake, not going to lie. I think he's probably my favorite character in that arc solely because that he gets so much to do.
He does so much shit.
Dude, my favorite moment in that entire show, in that entire arc, is with Brooke, and it's when they so they need to go get the picture.
Yeah,
because it's
I knew it. It was the picture thing.
And I didn't watch the anime for Vogue. I wasn't watching the anime at the time, so like I didn't see this moment animated. So I don't know how they did it, but in the manga, it's all in the background. So like you see like Luffy fighting like. You're fighting people, and then just in the background, you just see, like, Brooke just walking, and he walks up to the fucking picture, and he's just like, and it's... it's the funniest fucking thing I've ever seen in my life.
Well, and, in the show, the way they do it is, there's a lot of fighting going on, because the tea party's gone to shit, so everyone's fighting, and they're focusing on Luffy... He's taking on Big Mom, and then just out of nowhere, you hear glass shatter. And everyone's like, whoa! And then they look over, and there's fucking Brooke.
Fucking Brooke. Ah!
Paper to get ready for, was it One Piece Stampede? Is that the movie coming out?
Yes,
One Piece Stampede. I have been watching assorted random clips from One Piece, because I know I'm never gonna catch up. But if I start like at the beginning of Whole Cake, then I can just fucking guess everything. So that's what I'm gonna do. There's no Spencer's One Piece catch-up journey because that's for insane people. Instead, there's Spencer's skipping like not 300 episodes, going right to Whole Cake, and I'm gonna fucking figure it out. Next podcast, look for a session. Look for the entire section titled "Spencer's Confused by One Piece."
Yeah, Whole Cake is also 100 episodes. So.
Never mind, I'm starting from like
Whole Cake
20
is
episodes.
Long as shit. It's long as shit.
Figure it out.
Yeah, it's the second longest arc in the show.
And then when we all go to the movie, I'm gonna be like, "Don't worry, guys. I spent like the entire weekend." I spent 48 hours on the wiki, reading the wiki. I'm good to go.
But don't worry. Stampede is pretty much non-canon anyway. This is so you don't understand anything. You just need to know who the characters are.
All you need to know is that Luffy blows himself up like a balloon and becomes a basketball man.
Yes.
Stop.
No.
That's what you're for. Yeah.
All you need to know is that Luffy versus Katakuri is such a good fight that I'm pretty sure
it's the best fight in the entire series. Fight me.
It's so good. It's so good. It makes sense because Katakuri is pretty much Luffy's opposite in every
He's pretty much his powers have the same properties as Luffy's.
It's Mochi.
He knows how to utilize them in so many different ways that he's basically unstoppable. And he has a better, he uses hockey better, and his hockey's stronger, so he's like a brick wall, basically.
Oh. So, like, it's what, alright, so yeah, it's like one of those, I love Katakuri, by the way, as a character, not just as a villain, but as a character, I think he's great. Because he's like this stone cold badass at first. So you're like, but then when you actually see him, he's basically just a he's a fucking lazy slob, which I think is funny as fuck for I think it's funny as fuck because considering the way he was built up. Also, his mouth is amazing. The fact that the reveal of what his mouth actually looked like is. Really fucking funny.
Yeah, because they build him up as this like stoic badass who has never laid on his back once since he was born. His resolve is that great, and then he doesn't let people see him eat because he doesn't want to expose himself. It's like ooh, so mysterious and scary, and then Luffy fucking walks in on him eating, and he's just laying down like a fat ass. Fucking downing donuts. It's the funniest thing.
Yeah, fucking, the Whole Cake is a great arc for that. Like, there's literally a gingerbread man in this.
Oh, yeah, Cracker.
Yeah, his name is Cracker, and he's got the cracker fruit, and he's made of crackers.
He can just summon crackers, and he has an army of cracker people.
Was Oda just hungry during this arc?
There's literally a plot point during the fight between Luffy and Cracker where he has to eat all the crackers to beat him. So he just sits there and he eats all the crackers. He's like, fuck, I can't eat anymore, but I gotta.
Yeah, also Big Mom's devil fruit is really cool, actually.
Yeah, the soul fruit.
Soul fruit, where she can actually absorb the souls of people. And she has two clouds that follow her around, except one now follows Nami instead.
Yeah, because he's also a hungry fat ass.
I thought that was fun. Dude, Nami fucking threatens him with starvation if he doesn't follow her. I love Whole Cake. Whole Cake's great. And now you're in Wano.
Wano.
Now you're in Wano. I'm very excited for you to eventually catch up on Wano.
Wano was the entire reason this whole thing started to begin with, because I saw some stuff from the first few episodes, and I was like, I need to get on this shit.
Yeah.
And here we are, 800 episodes later.
Yeah, and now, so Wano is excellent. You should read the manga, honestly.
I'm going to. Catch up on Wano. Soon.
Because it's worth it, because it's so good right now. We're pretty much finishing up Act 2 of Wano right now. Because in the manga, Wano is being divided into three very specific acts near the end of Act 2. So we're pretty much going to be so the climax of it is coming very, very soon. Which in One Piece, climax means the second half an arc.
Yeah.
So
the climax is going to be another 40 chapters.
Yeah, pretty much. So although apparently Oda said he wants to finish Wano by the end of the year. So I think that I don't know. I don't know. I don't trust Oda ever when it comes to this. I don't know. But yeah, so you have officially caught up on One Piece.
Yes.
And any final thoughts?
When I finished, it was one of those what now moments. Like, I had been so used to watching it every day for the last like 6 weeks. I was like, what do I do with myself now?
Watch the movies. That's what you do.
I would if most of them weren't unlicensed, Matt.
But you should do it anyways, because they're probably not going to get licensed soon.
I know. So I probably should at some point.
Yeah.
I can't wait for the new dub voice for Sabo.
They're probably just going to get the guy who replaced him as Rompo.
Get Sean Schemmel.
Does he voice anyone in One Piece?
I don't think so, actually. I need to check.
He's like the one funny guy that they haven't cast in One Piece.
I need to check. Well, because he's also in fucking New York. He lives in Los Angeles, actually. He doesn't do everything with One Piece. Oh no, he's Hell Meppo. Never fucking mind. All right.
Excuse me.
Yeah, he's Hell Meppo. He's also Hachan too.
What?
Oh no, never mind. Now he was there in the Four Kids dub. Never mind. I'm a fucking idiot. Yeah, he is in One Piece. He is in the Funimation dub, though. He plays Dr. Indigo in the Funimation dub. I forget who that is. I don't even know who the fuck that is.
But
I'm looking that up. Who the fuck is Dr. Indigo?
Who is Dr. Indigo?
He's part of the Reservoir Dogs.
Dr. Indigo. Oh, he's one of the characters in One Piece Strong World.
So, you mean the one thing I didn't watch?
Yeah, so the movies. So just get him, because he's obviously not voicing anybody. So yeah.
Or they could just do what they did for Bungo, get the guy who they replaced him with for Rompo.
For Rompo?
Just get Travis Willingham again.
I mean, His character's dead, so he's available.
And fucking Travis Willingham was asked how he felt after Ace died. He was like, I fell out of a job.
That is the most Travis Willingham answer I've ever heard.
Just make him voice Sapo and don't explain at all why they have the same voice.
Same voice and the same devil fruit.
No, it's the same character.
Except he just has a top hat.
He just has a top hat and a pipe.
And he has the same fruit.
Yep.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm going to protect my brother. And Luffy's like, who?
Ooh. Ooh. No, because, Luffy knows
because apparently, yeah, because apparently, when Devil Fruit users die, their fruit gets repurposed out somewhere in the world again.
Yeah,
because that makes sense.
No, well, Devil Fruits have yet to be explained. I'm pretty sure it's some mythical thing that has yet to be explained yet.
It's magic. So, yeah.
More than likely, it is. Though to be fair, the One Piece world can get away with it because I'm pretty sure we've seen shit like this. They have snail phones, so we can get away with it.
Snail phones and snail video recorders, and there's an island on the back of a giant elephant. So,
who gives a shit? Alright, but yeah, let's move on to simulcast discussion, because I don't know if there's anything necessarily to talk about.
AKA, I have nothing to add.
I went on a fucking journey, boys. Let me talk about some shit that I have been watching. So, I don't work until October.
And before this section is an hour long.
No, it won't be. So, I'm completely caught up on Demon Slayer, and I 100% understand what he's talking about. After episode 19, this show is perfect. This show can get away with anything, especially episode 22, which once again ends on a stupid goddamn cliffhanger.
Stupid fucking cliffhanger!
Fuck. Really? Really? You votable? Maybe
the entire episode builds up to that moment, and they're like, nah, you gotta wait another week for that.
It's like, maybe if you paid your taxes on time, you wouldn't have to worry about these darn cliff ends. But yeah, Demon Slayer, really good.
Really good.
I'm gonna say this politely, is that Matt, when you have the time, I would start it.
Yeah. I'm waiting for it to finish.
Okay. There's only four episodes left.
Four episodes left.
When episode 19 happened, I was like, I'm gonna watch. I mean, I was gonna watch it regardless.
Actually.
Good, because I'm like, I'm just gonna wait till it's done because I'm not starting a show and then having three episodes left. I've done that with shows before, and it sucks because then I can never truly enjoy it. So
I did that. That anime is outstanding.
Oh yeah.
And in one episode basically clinch my insert song of the year.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So good. And it's not a simulcast, but I do want to talk a little bit about it. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how in one day I finished Mob Psycho 100 Season 2.
Anime of the fucking year.
Anime of the decade.
That anime is something special. That was so good. And what episode was it? Was episode 8?
Episode with the house?
Yeah, with the house. Mm-hmm. Episode 8?
Eight.
Yeah, the end of 8 where I'm like, 0 to 10. This anime fucking trash here.
I hate all of you. This is the worst.
This is the worst. And then I watched the next episode and what the fuck? This is stupid.
Yeah, I lied to you about that.
Yes, that's multiple times.
I fucking led you on just so you wouldn't be fucking. You could play into it.
Yeah,
But yeah.
Oh yeah, they're actually dead, dude.
Yeah, they're not coming back. They're actually dead. He killed his entire
last
family.
The last time you did this to me was fucking release the spice.
Oh yeah.
With my girl.
Yeah.
The triple agent. Yeah.
Yeah. Triple agent.
I was like, no, but
yeah, twist, she's the bad guy. Second twist, she's not.
She's not the bad guy. She was just working for the... Oh, that's so good, man.
But she's just working for the bad guy.
Mob Psycho 100 Season 2. Amazing.
Still my anime of the year. Easy.
Yeah, same here.
I'll have to see what everything else brings, but...
Nothing will beat it.
It's Mob. It's Mob.
Nothing's gonna beat it. That's why...
This is like Place Further. It's like it aired right at the beginning of the year and nothing topped it.
Except review.
For me, at least.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. Like, the only thing I could see beating this is maybe MHA this year, because I've seen some shit from MHA coming up.
Did you see the new trailer?
They're going Hana Hana route, and they're not doing a strict like panel to panel adaptation like they usually do.
Thank
with this. They're
going. God.
Straight up, from what I've heard of this season, this is going to be This is straight up going to be one of the best seasons of shonen ever made, pretty much. So get ready.
I'm hype.
I saw some stuff in that trailer from the Kirishima fight, and.
I told you that the Kirishima stuff is going to be great. Like,
dude,
everyone keeps telling. Oh, nah. Kirishima's first fucking fight in the manga is what in the manga at that point when he's like, and when he activates like the stone mode, like whatever, like the fucking
Godstone, or it's called
Godstone, or whatever the fuck. That's one of my favorite moments in the entire series. So like, I'm so happy that it's coming,
dude. But just, I can't wait for that, and like the stuff with Fat Gum as well.
Fat Gum,
dude. Fat Gum's so cool.
Who are they gonna get for Fat Gum in the dub? I wonder.
I think he has a dub voice because he. I think he got Cat because he's in the first episode of the season. So I need to fucking Fat Gum. I think he got cast. So I'm gonna check right now. I think he's been cast in Japanese. I know that for sure. But I don't know exactly by who.
The actual title for that mode that Kirishima is called Red Riot Unbreakable.
Yeah, Unbreakable. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was just sitting here like, Godstone, what are you talking about?
Because I'm thinking of fucking Godspeed from Demon. It's like, it's something that Zenitsu can do.
That's not Godspeed, though.
No.
Godspeed is Hunter Hunter, dude.
Godspeed is also Demon Slayer. I read the wiki.
Yeah, Godspeed is in both shows.
But,
goddamn
it. Last show I want to talk about is I got caught up on Fire Force. Why is this show so gorgeous?
Episode 8, dude.
Episode 8, dude. I just watched it today.
Some of the best boarding I've seen all year.
If I knew what... Oh, storyboarding. Okay. Boarding. Jason Bourne.
Jesus Christ, it's Jason Bourne.
Jason Bourne. That episode, that's not what causes the spontaneous combustion, but it's how you make like artificial infernals. And I mean, it's pretty interesting. But
I still don't know how I feel about it.
I think it's simple and it'll work, and as long as that's not what's actually causing spontaneous combustion.
Okay, if that is the actual cause of the combustion, it's going to be JoJo levels of stupid. Like, hey, stands or aliens.
So, yeah, it's going to be real dumb. But I think that's only how you make artificial infernals. And also, shout out to Lieutenant Flam, who has the coolest fucking power ever. Thermoacoustics.
Where he uses sound to freeze shit.
He uses sound, which has its own heat signature, to... Basically, he has a musical instrument, and when he plays it, he releases sound energy that he can transfer the heat to and then cool down to make ice. It's actually really cool, even though it sounds fun. But those are the three that I want to talk about. I don't know if you want to talk about anything else. Dr. Stone's good.
I'm pretty much good. Shane, you good?
My opinions on anything hasn't changed, so I got nothing to contribute.
Yeah, this season is very consistent in its quality in terms of just shows. Everything's the same as it was at the start of the season, and will probably be the same at the end of the season. All right, let's move on to the news then. If we got nothing else to talk about, our first piece of news is about Haikyuu. The Haikyuu Zenshu Sai. I probably butchered that.
You butchered the fuck out of that. What did you even say?
I don't know. Event announced on Sunday that the fourth season of the Haikyuu television anime will premiere in January of 2020. It's going to be winter 2020 show.
Winter show.
At the Super Animes of Time Stop on MBS. It also reveals some of the new designs and cast members. And Production IG is confirmed to be working on the fourth season now. IG's coming back, but no word on staff at all, on whether or not it's the same staff.
There were rumblings that it's completely different staff that I heard, at least.
The rumblings I heard is that it's the same writer and director, but the major staff has changed. Major animation staff has changed. Which is kind of an issue, because the reason they don't have any footage to show is because apparently they haven't started yet. So, like, that's the... or at the very least, they're not close to being done, which is kind of a problem.
And also they have two OVAs airing the same time, so...
Yeah.
And the teams are separate, and the teams are split, because they had a separate team working on the OVAs, and blah, 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 blah. So, this season could look like poo. But I don't think it will.
If it looks like poo, it's gonna suck, because those new character designs and the new art style look so damn good.
Yeah.
I haven't seen the new character designs.
Yeah, from what I've seen, it's pretty much like the same designs, but like a little smoother, and that's pretty much it.
Mm-hmm.
They look a bit more like the manga.
Okay.
Yeah, just tiny bit more, nothing too major. It's not that big of a change, to be honest. Like, I only noticed it because, hey, the line work is a little bit more detailed, a little bit more outlined. There's a little bit more of a black outline around them, because they gave them that black outline, you see.
Yeah, it reminds me of the Toei's new line filter that they started using with Broly. It's got those really thick, inky lines.
Is that going to be the new thing in anime now because Broly did so well?
I hope it does, because that's my favorite art style. It's just the thick lines.
At the same time, though, I'm like, I don't want everyone to do the exact same thing, because then I'm going to be sick of it. I like the multitude of art styles. I like sometimes having like the more complicated character designs, or like the more simplistic character. I like having a variety. If everything looks the fucking same, I'm not gonna care about it anymore.
Yeah, don't worry about it. We still got Yuasa, who's just gonna do his own fucking weird shit.
We still got Yuasa, who's gonna do like people who don't look like people.
People who don't look like people, but also kind of move like people. It's weird.
Also, Shane used to watch the Hosoda One Piece film, because that shit looked. That shit's incredible.
I get it.
but Haikyuu is coming in January 2020. I thought it was going to come in October, but apparently not. So that's coming. Speaking of another sports show, but this time it is in the fall, Ahu no Sora, which is a show that is going to start airing in October, which is a anime based on a very popular basketball manga.
Okay, so it's the basketball one. All right.
And it revealed that it will be running for 4 core. It's a 1-year show.
52? Wow.
They did not specify how many episodes, but it'll be 4 core, and it's going to be 4 core all the way through. Not no gap, no nothing.
So it's going to run for a full year.
Yeah, just a full year, yeah. We're seeing a lot more of this nowadays. A lot more of this now. Yep. Fruits Basket, Fire Force, this is not, we normally don't see this. Don't, we don't, normally don't, The show will be directed by Shingo Tamaki, who is directing the anime at Studio Dio Media. Previously, Tamaki has not really worked as a director before. He has directed a couple of things, but nothing too major. Go Zappa, however, is writing the show.
Okay, so we're good.
Yeah. It's not an ecchi, so do not worry, Shane.
I hope it isn't.
But what gets me excited is that this is the first anime to have the people doing the opening theme is the fucking Pillows. The Pillows. The Pillows from the first anime they brought on.
From the hit cult anime Fooly Cooly?
Yes. Those Pillows. The Pillows are doing the opening theme.
That we've covered previously on this show?
Yes, Shane. You can go
link
find
in the description.
You can go find the link to the FLCL podcast in the description. I don't know if it's
going it won't be in the description. I'm telling
you.
Yeah,
it won't
right
be
now.
There. Just go look in our fucking channel for it. I don't know. The story follow now tell me if you've heard this story before. In this story, 15-year-old Sora Kumatani is only 4'10" tall. Wow, he's only 4'10". The fuck?
Oh, no.
But he loves basketball. He enthusiastically joins the basketball club as soon as he gets to high school. But the club is comprised of two terrifying twins who rule the school and their friends. Can Sora continue in this kind of club? It's literally
high Q. It's high Q.
It's high Q
with
basketball.
It's literally high Q.
Just replace the characters with Hinata and Kageyama. It's the same damn show.
They did release a PV for it, though, and I don't know if you guys have seen it, but I've seen it, and it looks really good, actually.
I'm watching it right now.
It's super good.
It's definitely one of the fall shows that stuck out the most to me, because honestly, I feel the same way about fall like I did summer. Kind of dead, all things considered.
They got My Hero, but...
Other than that, and a few others.
And Shiata Fuyu.
They got Beastars.
Netflix.
Beastars got picked up by Netflix, though, because they have a deal with Sanrio, and apparently Sanrio's involved with fucking Beastars in some capacity, so that's why.
So Beastars is dead to me.
Yeah. So wow. Beastars, I'm still going to watch that shit, though.
Yeah, when it comes out in 6 months.
Kill on Tuesday's out, and I'm going to watch that, so... Spencer is probably watching it right now.
I'm not. I'm watching the PV for that basketball show.
That's what I meant. Whoop.
Oh, yes, I am. Sorry. Yeah. That man just picked up a table and threw it at a bunch of basketball players. Basketball. Oh, layup.
What is this? Whiplash?
Oh, what?
That whiplash on the ground, basketball. Sweating. There's a basketball.
J.K. Simmons is a disgruntled basketball coach.
No, J.K. Simmons is the basketball.
CGI graft his face onto a basketball.
It is his face.
Oh my god, there's even bird symbolism. This is just haiku with that. Orange it's and IQ. Black. They wear orange and black.
It's literally Kurosano.
It's literally haiku.
Oh, no, sorry. Wait, no. They might wear orange and black, or it's their... like practice jerseys. Regardless, it's just Karasuno.
It's just high school basketball.
No, they wear. I'm pretty sure they wear orange and black. Damn! Congratulations, just Karasuno.
Congratulations, you officially ripped off IQ.
Congratulations! Shout out to the anime Radiant.
What?
I'm looking at the anime coming out. Oh, the gun anime.
The gun anime.
That comes out next month.
Okay, let's move on with the news.
Move on. Because I'm losing my shit right now. Yeah.
Okay, our next piece of news came from Anime Expo or around that time, so there's going to be a lot of stuff that came out. The first of all, we're going to cover the biggest one probably from Crunchyroll Expo, and that's Junji Ito's manga Uzumaki is getting an anime. It's the Junji Ito panel of Crunchyroll Expo announced on Friday that Ito's Uzumaki horror manga will have an anime adaptation. Hiroshi Nagahama, who directed The Flowers of Evil and Mushishi, is directing the miniseries of Production IG. And Adult Swim Tsunami Blood will release the anime in the United States before Japan. They even announced who's composing the music, and it will be famed Hollywood composer Colin Stetson, who has worked with Ari Aster on both Midsommar and Hereditary. So, and the anime is going to be 4 episodes long, so it's not going to be like a huge, like fucking, it's not going to be a huge stand.
It's a mini series.
It's a mini series. However, they did release a teaser for it.
Yes, they did. And
that went viral because oh my god. It looks real good. It looks real good, boys.
And they're sticking to manga coloring.
They're sticking to manga coloring. The spirals and the hair are all CG, apparently.
But it looks really good.
Yeah, it looks really good. And if it's directed by the guy who did Mushishi, this is going to be a slow ass burn.
It could also be sad.
That was when Matt was like
terrifying.
Officially sold.
Oh, so it's like that's the best choice. Apparently Junji Ito like picked him personally or something like that. Because I'm like that.
Because Junji Ito is very protective of his.
The last time Uzumaki got turned into something, it was the live action movie, and it wasn't that good.
And the most recent adaptation of any of his work was the Junji Ito collection, and we all know how that turned out.
Apparently he actually liked that, but I don't know.
A moron.
I don't know. But in any case, fucking Uzumaki is pretty great. I love the manga so much, and I'm happy it's finally getting
How long is the manga for Uzumaki?
Like six volumes.
I own it. It's not that long.
So four episodes. No word on how long each episode will be.
It's around half an hour each, because they're structuring it like a 2-hour movie, pretty much. Okay. They're making it like. So it's going to be like 30 minutes each, more than likely.
So it's going to be like 2 hours.
It's going to be like 2 hours, which you can fit Uzumaki into a 2-hour runtime. It's not going to be that hard. You may have to cut some things, but most of it, the only stuff you need to cut is probably like minuscule shit. Uzumaki is also spooky as fuck. So
oh my god. It is like terrifying. Page turn after page turn, you're like, oh no.
I mean, Junji Ito is the master of the page turn.
He is.
Yeah, he's great. And he's the only one that's made spirals like the most horrifying fucking thing on the planet. So
every time I see a spiral now, I get PTSD.
You will after this. But I am very, very excited for this. Hopefully it does not suck. It probably will not. We'll be definitely checking it out. It will be airing sometime in 2020, so it's next year. So we'll get forward to that. Speaking of stuff that will be far less traumatizing than fucking Uzumaki, Eurocamp. Let's talk about Eurocamp, because they finally announced when that's coming back. At the very least, they announced when the short anime is coming back, which is the first thing that's coming, and that's in January. They released a trailer for it, and it pretty much looks like Eurocamp.
Man, it sucks that Josh isn't on this episode.
Yeah, it pretty much looks exactly like what Eurocamp. So, like, can you? So, I was gonna say like, it's pretty much like it looks like just. Short versions of episodes. They changed the art style a bit for the short anime.
Is it more chibi?
Nope. Guess what it fucking has?
Oh, does it have the freaking line filter?
Yep.
Of course.
Everything has it now.
Everyone's just on the thick black line bandwagon, apparently.
Yep.
They're like, man, Broly did good job. I want to be Broly. Let's be Broly. not knowing that that Broly worked because it was supposed to look like a goddamn manga from the 80s.
Meanwhile, EuroCamp is not based on anything. It's based on itself. So
EuroCamp is based off EuroCamp. And we should all respect EuroCamp because it is...
It's very nice. Comfy.
It's very comfy. It's comfy. Nice.
Comfy. Do you want to feel comfy? Watch EuroCamp because you're gonna wanna you're gonna get a sleeping bag, you're gonna get a tent, and you're just gonna want to camp.
I'm pretty sure Josh set up a tent in his room while he watched that.
It wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, we really wouldn't.
Wow. But yeah. Next up on the news is something that came out of it. I'm only bringing this up. Normally, I would not bring this up. Because, of course, this would happen, but the Pokemon Sun and Moon anime is wrapping up, obviously, since Sword and Shield's coming out. And of course, that means it's time for the next one. But I'm bringing this up because it's fascinating to me, because the next one is not going to be exactly what we expected. It's not going to be called... Apparently, the new season is just called Pokemon. Nothing else. They're not giving it a subtitle.
What does that mean?
And it will be featuring every region from Kanto to the newest one, which is Galar.
Huh?
The rumor is that this is a complete reboot, actually.
So they're rebooting the anime?
Yeah, that they're rebooting it. Is that they're completely rebooting it from the ground up, because this is a completely new staff from what it looks like. So it's looking like that... Whatever this new form is, it's not going to be what we... not the same show that we've seen for, like, the past couple decades. For, like, the past two decades. Which... All right. I'm just fascinated. I'm more just fascinated as to what the fuck this is, more than anything.
Yeah, I would expect you to ride off the coattails of, you know, the new game that's coming out. But...
I mean, Galar's in it, but, like, I don't know what the fuck it's gonna be. Fuck it. We'll get more details on the episode that I believe is the final episode of Sun and Moon, but I don't know. Continuing on with that news, we got two more big pieces of news from Crunchyroll Expo. The first piece of news is about Shield Hero, Rising of Shield Hero, which announced on the Crunchyroll Expo, that Shield Hero is not getting one, but two new seasons, both of which that are in production. They release also new visual for the second season. There is no word on when the seasons will air. My question is, does this mean that the seasons are back to back?
I have no idea.
Because you normally do not announce two more seasons of anime unless they're like back to back seasons.
Yeah, usually it's like, hey, season two is coming, and then after that's done, you announce a third season. But they're like, no, here's two and three. They're coming, like, guys.
Season two and three. My guess is that both seasons are like 13 episodes, but they're split. That's probably
what it is. Yeah, that would make sense. Because I'm like, okay. The first season was a double core. It was 25. If both 2 and 3 are also 25, that's 75 episodes, 50 new ones. Do they have enough material to fit 50 episodes?
They do.
I don't know I don't know how much they covered in the first season. They did cover a lot, so...
I believe it was up to the 5th light novel, I believe it was.
And there's like 20, so...
Yeah, there's a lot of light novels. They have enough material. No, they do.
They have enough... And also it depends on how fast they adapt, how fast they go, how much they adapt, what they cut, what they don't cut.
Because didn't they end the first season in the middle of an arc?
Yeah.
No, not really. The book just ends there.
The book just ends it. What they did was that they ended the main story like on episode 21, and it just kept going.
For four episodes.
I mean, that's still better than fucking Slime.
Slime just kept going. Well, no,
Slime ended and then went, okay, but what if we didn't?
Slime's ending, season one ending, was not a... It's just a normal episode, which I find fucking funny.
Yeah.
It's like episode 22, and they're like, okay, see you next time. And you're just like, what?
And then the next episode was like a... Then there was like that extra episode, and then the recap episode.
And then the OVA.
I haven't seen the OVA yet, like, so I don't know if it's even worth watching.
And it's just a beach episode, so...
Oh, so not like worth watching this.
There you go.
Why are all light novel episodes... Why do they all have beach episodes? I don't care. Hey, I don't care if they're at the beach.
It's not a light novel.
I never go to the beach myself. Stop being happy. Stop going to the beach.
That's just the Japan thing.
Stop enjoying your life.
Japan, for some reason, loves the beach. Meanwhile, it's probably because we live in Canada, and there's, like, no beaches that have actual warm water because we live in fucking Canada. And... Okay. Japan is just like, LOL, we're near the equator. Fuck off.
Fuck off. Fuck off. But yeah, Shield Hill's getting two more seasons, so if you care about that, you're getting two more seasons.
Which I do.
Yeah,
The last piece of news is about Space Battleship Yamato.
Okay.
Yeah, the Space Battleship Yamato, because they announced the sequel to the sequel. That was a sequel to the original series, which was a remake of the original series, which also had its sequel.
What?
Don't ask. The official website for Space Battleship Yamato 2202, the anime film revealed the title. It'll have a they basically revealed when the anime the film sequel will come out, and it'll be in fall 2020. So it's way too far off to give a fuck. But the official title of the film is Space Battleship Yamato 2205: A New Journey, which is, means it's likely based on which means it's likely going to be based on. The third season of the anime, more of the original series, more than likely. Space Battleship Yamato is one of those things where I never got into it, but I think everyone should watch it personally because it's one of those very important shows from the 80s that influenced a lot of people, influenced a lot of different anime creators. Specifically, Hideki Anno cites it as a massive influence on Eva. So if you're a fan of Eva, I highly recommend you check out Space Battleship Yamato, the very least.
I don't know anything about Space Battleship Yamato. The only Yamato I know is fucking Virgil's sword and DMC.
That's the only Yamato I know. Space Battleship Yamato is about a fucking warship in space.
Yeah,
like a literal classic Japanese warship in space. And it's basically fucking Star Trek, but if Star Trek met Legend of the Galactic Heroes, met Star Wars, met Gundam.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I caught all that.
So, you caught all... Yes, you did. No, I don't think you did.
No, I did.
But yeah, there's going to be more of this. There's going to be more of this, and there's always going to be more of this. But it's also here in North America, it's better known as Star Blazers. Star Blazers is the thing it's most normally known as here, because we got a version of it in the 80s on TV that wasn't nearly as good because it was the 80s and it was 80s dubbing, so everything was changed.
Oh yeah,
and in English. It's exactly how you think it is. So there is that. Anyways, that's all for the news. I think we're pretty much ready to go then to talk about our featured anime of the podcast, which is the 2009 film Redline, directed by Takeshi Koike and written by Kasuhito Ichi, Yoji Ikenikido, and Yoshiyuki Sakurai. It's from Studio Madhouse, and it initially premiered on August 14th, 2009. And it was officially released in October 9th, 2010. It took a whole year to premiere. And the film is currently licensed by nobody.
We found this out. Spencer and I found this out after we recorded the last episode. You can legally view Redline. It is legally available on Tubi TV to stream.
On Tubi TV.
The only show that we've covered on this podcast that's on Tubi TV. But it's on there.
Yeah.
And Tubi TV is legal.
Yeah, it's a little hard to find because the distribution for it is handled by Manga Entertainment, and it was the final film released by Manga Entertainment before the American division of Manga Entertainment went dormant. So this is the last. So, but Manga Entertainment is the current license holder for it. So it's a little difficult to find.
Actually, it's not really. You can buy it on Amazon for like $14.
But I don't know if we're gonna get another. I don't know if we're ever going to get another release of it then. But in any case, Redline is set in the distant future where there is a race known as the Redline. What is the Redline? Fuck if I know. But it's pretty much
big fucking race.
It's a big race between the best racers in the galaxy who compete each other for fame, glory, and cash. Our main character is G.A.P, the man with the coolest hair in the galaxy, as he competes in Redline due to pretty much a coincidence. And that's literally the story of the movie. There's nothing else you need to know about that. Sweet J.P. He looks like he came out of fucking Greece.
He's like he has the greatest pompadour in all of entertainment history.
The pompadour is so great that in the thumbnail for this video, it is the half the size of the thumbnail.
It is literally half the thumbnail.
Is his hair? Let's talk about Redline's chain. How is Redline? Is Redline?
I don't fucking know. If you look up the definition of exhilarating in the dictionary, you will probably see a picture of Redline next to it because holy shit. Redline has some of the best animation I've seen in any anime movie. It has a great soundtrack. It's got fantastic directing and storyboarding. Everything else is kind of garbo, though. Like everything about this movie from a production standpoint is fantastic, but narrative wise what even is this movie about? Like, who are these characters? What are they doing? Why are they doing it? I don't know, and the movie doesn't really care, even though it spends so much time building it up. But, you know, whatever. You're here to see cool fucking animated racing. That's all you care about. Right?
Yeah, pretty much.
That's all I got. It's cool, I guess.
Alright, so Spencer, what do you think of Redline?
Redline made me sad.
What a wonderful way to start.
Not because it's bad. In fact, it's fucking beautiful. This 100% was a passion project. You can see it in the movie. You can see it in the fucking art direction. God, this movie's gorgeous. You can see it in the way that it's animated. You can see in the way that this was fucking hand-drawn. Over 100,000 cells. Like, dude, Akira already did it. You don't need to do it. You can use computers. It's okay. We're not going to blame you. It's 2010. You know, 2009, maybe. We're not going to blame you. But they went, nah. On the Blu-ray special extras menu, the voice actor for JP, the Japanese voice actor for JP, was like, hey, I'm a voice actor, I can't really talk about the technical stuff, but I think that we care too much about computers, and we use them too much. So all of the staff decided that we're not going to use computers, and we're going to draw everything. And I'm like, you're fucking stupid. You are dumb. You are ridiculous, okay? If you have a computer, you can use a computer. Thank you for not using a computer, though. Because this movie's good. Very good. However, that's all I can say, is it's really good. Because, boy, does it have a lot lacking in the 20 different plot holes that it leaves unresolved. And I'm being generous when I say 20. There's probably more. But no, it's good. I enjoyed it, watched it the first time, and I'm glad I watched it.
All right. Redline is the... If a Redline is quite possibly, actually it more than likely is, the absolute dumbest movie I have ever seen. And I love it. And I love it. I wouldn't have it any other way in terms of its stupidity. It is absolutely bonkers. It's nuts. It's insane. It runs on rule of cool. It does not run on logic. It runs on, hey, this looks cool. Let's fucking do that. And it works.
I'm pretty sure the entire movie runs on JP's hair.
The entire movie runs on the idea that, does anyone actually care? No? Okay, we don't either. Let's go. And it's great. If you haven't... So let's talk about... Redline. Now, Redline is a movie. There's no episodes here. Although there was an OVA that was released like 7 years before the movie came out as like a test version of Redline. Never officially, never licensed. We can't have a best episode. We can't have a favorite episode or best episode. So instead, we have come up with, what is our favorite moment from Redline? Shane, do you have any specific moment from Redline where that made you go, oh?
I guess technically it would be the ending of the movie, because it is the final scene in the movie when all the racers on the Redline hit their platinum nitro boost all at once, and they're all freaking nitro boosting the shit out of their cars.
I was going to pick the same. So.
Yeah, and it comes down to JP and Sonashi in one car taking on Machine Head, whose entire character trait is that his head is a machine. His head is a giant battery.
He is the car.
And then they pop the amulet into the nitro tank, and the car fucking explodes. But then the explosion of the car propels them across the finish line on foot. And it is the most insane, dumb, wacky bullshit I've ever seen. But I was like...
They literally win by a hair. They literally win by a hair, dude. I love it. Spencer, do you have any specific moment from Redline that made you go, oh?
God, there was a bunch of them, actually. Because this 100%, Matt, you're right. The rule of cool. If it looks cool, it is cool. But I want to be different, okay? That's I don't want to, because we all, or at least me and Shane, would both agree that it is the end of the movie, that entire scene with the platinum boot at first. But I'm going to go with the beginning of the movie, the race on the yellow line. When JP hits his gold nitro, and then the fucking camera like elongates, and he has a bloody nose, and he like, you see like the tears in his eyes as he goes for a second shot of nitro just to try to win the race. And he's about to beat Sonoshi McLaren and go on to Redline, and then his car explodes. And he's like, misses it. And then it cuts to him in the hospital. He's like, well.
And then he fucking dies.
Yeah. But that was like, okay, this is going to be high octane. This is going to be speed. This is going to be like The bee's knees, my friend.
And then the movie kind of lies to you because the entire second act has no racing, so it's like 40 minutes of just talking for no reason.
Yeah, and then it...
Sorry.
I was gonna say, like it starts with like a 15-minute race, 40 minutes of talking, and then race, and then over. Like,
and that's then the movie. It just ends.
So expensive.
Mm-hmm.
What were you gonna say?
Oh, I was gonna say, and that means is, and not for the reason that you think it is, but it's when they're introducing all of the racers, and like, you know, when Sonoshi is like relaxing at home and just watching the TV, and it's like, these are all of the different racers, and it's like, oh, okay, so you got these two females, they're from an all-women planet, and the princess can use magic, and she works for Redline, and they're kind of like pop stars. Okay, I get their character, right? And then you come to the fucking Tadaki, oh my god, what are their names?
I know who you're talking to. Mercenary Boys.
Yeah, no, not the Merc Boys, the people that have, like, the fucking, like, spider bot that, like, they have to, like...
Oh, Todoroki and Miki, I think.
Todoroki and Miki, where the first thing Todoroki says is, yeah, fuck you! It's just fucking bleeps out.
You motherfucker!
You motherfucker! It's just, like, getting so upset, and it's one of the greatest, because it's like, okay, these characters are one-dimensional. But if there's anything anime has taught me, it's that if you make their one dimension something so easily recognizable, then you can still have really good characters that are one dimensional. But they just need to be like an interesting or a fun dimension. And that's also a really good scene. Also, shout out to the man who had to animate Sonoshi's tits. You did a good job, buddy. Imagine.
Oh, okay.
No, but no. Sure though. Imagine putting that on your fucking portfolio and applying for a job, and it's like, oh, what animation work did you do? And you just go, remember the scene where she has her shirt off?
You know the scene where they keep the camera conveniently on her legs? And you see she wearing pants, and it just cuts up. It's, oh, they're out. Oh.
Whoa, that took me for a ride. Whoa. Japan. Oh. How scantily clad. Right. Is this woman named McLaren? That's not a Japanese name.
None of the characters. You want to know what JP's actual name is? Joshua Punkhead.
Joshua Punkhead?
Wait.
Wait, what?
That's his actual name, is Joshua Punkhead.
Punkhead. So his actual nickname is Sweet Joshua
Punkhead. Oh, Lord, kill me now.
There's a guy in this who's named after a fucking Frisbee.
His name's literally Frisbee.
And I don't know what he is.
He's like an alien.
He is a green alien man.
He is an alien.
And also, shout out to the man who has like four arms and but still actually only has two legs.
Yeah, the weird spider dude who's not really a spider, but
the mechanic guy, mechanic man,
whatever the fuck his name was.
His name is Old Man Mole.
Yeah. Who fucking blasts the head off of a mob doctor and just goes, yeah, what's up, bitch? Comes through the window and like,
I see you're doing cocaine. Plap, plap.
Speaking of characters, let's talk about characters. We don't watch Redline but characters, but we gotta pick one anyways. Who's your favorite character from Redline?
I'm cheating because mine's a tie. Because these two characters are the only ones that really left an impression. But my favorite characters are JP and Sonishi. Obviously, they're the best characters in the entire movie. Like,
I was gonna go with Sonishi personally,
and I was gonna go with JP.
Then I'll be the middleman and pick both.
I like Sonishi because I think Sonishi has the most fleshed out character of.
Oh, she 100% does.
And she has a history in racing, and she feels an obligation to win the red line because of, you know, her childhood.
Yeah,
and you know, she's a woman, and she's like, I gotta prove it. Yeah, I like racing.
I have to prove myself to all these men out here.
Yeah, and he's like, hey, your stuff's broken. Why don't you hitch a ride in my Trans Am?
Or you can hitch a ride on my Trans Am if you know what I'm
saying. Yeah.
And he's like, it's a little snug, tight. But I like it that way. And she's like, yeah, I do too.
Yeah. And I'm like, all right, movie. let's discuss why JP and Sonishi are the two characters in the movie that left an impression on you.
Because the movie doesn't do anything with any of the other characters whatsoever. Even the ones they build up, like the president of RoboWorld, there's like they just disappear by the end anyway. So who fucking cares?
So let's move in. Who's your least favorite character, by the way?
Well, president of RoboWorld.
I was gonna say same thing. He doesn't do anything.
He's like your most stereotypical. I'm the leader of an evil organization.
When they said RoboWorld, I was like, RoboWorld?
Yeah, you would expect a world made consisting entirely of robots, right?
No.
They're
like cyborgs.
They're like cyborg people?
The cyborg people who do biological experimentation.
And they have refugees. Giant baby kaijus.
And the president has to like hit the vape every once in a while for some reason.
What was that supposed to be? That's the Secretary of Defense.
No. The president has that fucking like bendy straw that he like sucks on every once in a while. And I'm like, I'm like, what is the meaning of this?
Maybe it's got space cocaine in it.
Dude, just like the old man?
Yeah.
Do you think he bought it from the old man in his two side hoes?
Probably.
Who pieced the fuck out?
Okay, here's the thing about the president of RoboWorld, right? Not only is he the most generic, big government official bad guy I've ever seen, he is also that fucking old dude who, like, yells at people to get off their lawn, except it's an entire planet.
Yeah.
Like, get off my RoboWorld, you damn racers!
I don't want Redline on my planet. This is a disgrace to galactic law. And it's like, no, it's a disgrace to your fucking ego.
It's okay. I'm gonna get a bit political here. So hashtag politics. Right. But it reminded me a lot of like the Iranian nuclear deal, where Iran is like, sure, we don't have any nukes. You can come check in, except for these factories. You can't look in these factories. Except it's an entire country where the president's like, yo, we're doing like biological experiments, and like we have a lot of really, really high tech.
We got a lot of fucked up shit that we can't have people seeing.
It's actually against like war codes. So we're going to stop this race and kill everybody, because that makes more sense
You can come to RoboWorld and you can, like, explore, be a tourist, that's fine. Just don't go underground. Don't go underground. There might be baby kaijus underground. Don't go underground.
What the fuck was that?
It was just a biological weapon.
I looked at it, I'm like, what the hell is that?
It's a weird mutant baby kaiju. But then apparently they also have some sort of technology that can turn people into those things. Because the fucking colonel goes underground and he's like, well, we gotta stop this. And then he, like, pops some weird pill. And then he turns into a kaiju.
And then they fight. Never seen again.
And then they just disappear. So, like, what the fuck?
And fucking Alto. Also, the colonel's name is Voltan.
Yeah, Voltan.
Yeah.
Not to be confused with Voltron.
No. That's copyright infringement. We can't do that.
Yeah, not to be confused by that. All right, let's talk about what we're actually going to talk about, and that's the animation, because, oh my god.
Mm.
Oh my god.
Ugh. They made it way too far.
Oh my god. Fuck it. For the first frame of this movie, it's just kind of like, oh, I know what we're in for. This movie looks amazing.
Oh yeah.
When it's a black screen and it's just like people have given up racing on wheels, except for one man, and then you hear a rum, and it's like, oh. And then it starts and it's like these aliens are like placing bets and there's a lot of movement in the frame.
There's so much character acting in this movie. Like subtle character animation.
Yeah, it is. And it's all great. It's all great.
And of course, you know, what we're here to talk about is the actual racing itself, because it looks godlike.
It's Speed Racer on crack.
That's what I said. It's basically Speed Racer on crack. Like, every little bit of it.
Like, fucking, remember the live-action Speed Racer and how that was on crack? It's the crack on crack.
It's like if you took the live-action remake of an anime and then turned it back into anime.
Yeah, it's pretty much that. And I don't mind in the slightest, because this looks amazing.
No, it looks incredible. The one thing, animation-wise, that I really want to talk about, it's the thing that stands out the most, is the use of warped perspective, which really sells the velocity of these cars as they're fucking hauling ass down these racetracks, because like everyone will like pop their nitro and then the camera will just go whoop and then it'll go wacky crazy warped perspective and it'll just JP's hair is like 5 miles long and it's incredible.
Shout out to the music.
Yes, I know you want to talk about the music, so please, go for it.
Oji is a Asian. He's half American, half Asian, half Japanese, and he was born in but he was born in Japan. So, and his music is very it's like a mix of like synth, electronic, metal, rock, and just like adrenaline fueled like groove music, and it's great. Yeah. It gets your blood pumping. That's what it does.
It reminded me of like
the tone of the Jet Set Radio to perfection.
Like that's what it reminded me of, Matt. It remind like some of these tracks were like straight out of Jet Set Radio. Yes.
Yes.
Did you join? You joined.
Yes. It was me.
Oh, okay.
No, he just dropped like a fucking fool.
Oh, okay. No, I was saying like some of these tracks sound like right out of Jet Set Radio. Like it's that kind of like that electronic synthy kind of exactly what Matt's saying, like groove music. I love every character has their own like kind of like theme song where it's just like a crowd just like chanting their name with like some like and even like the main theme of Redline is so like gut-punchingly like exciting, and that's what this movie is. It's exciting. You cannot sit through this movie and call it boring. This is not a boring movie.
Oh, no, hell no.
And, like, the music just kind of really encompasses what the mood is at that point. So, like, if something exciting is happening, like, if he punches that platinum nitro, then the music's like, okay, it's time for you to get excited. Like, this is hype. You better be hype. And it even if you weren't, it kind of tricks you because you're like, maybe I am hype. Yeah, this is
maybe hype. Just maybe.
Maybe.
I might be a little bit hype.
Let me check my hype meter. Yep, I'm hype.
Yeah, oh, Oh, it broke the scale. Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
It appears that I have a hypitis.
It appears I have in fact died.
And then be reborn by the music acting as a defibrillator. I also like that every vehicle has their own unique look to it.
Same.
Like, no two racers look the same. Like, I can pick them apart by their vehicle. And they all, you know, fit the character. Like, J.P. is this greaser 1950s looking motherfucker who drives a Trans Am. Which, wow, how'd you get the rights to that? Because that's an actual car.
But I'm pretty sure Shaughnessy's last name is McLaren.
McLaren, which is another car brand, so they must have got some licensing, and it's like, you know what, let's just use the licensing. If we have it, might as well use it. Mm-hmm. And, like, Machine Head is part, he is the car. The car is him.
I love Machine Head's design, by the way. Yeah. And it's a shame he doesn't do anything, to be honest. I wish he did more, because his design is so cool. But then he just kind of, like, doesn't really do anything, and he just kind of yells.
Yeah, he just yells a lot, and he's like, I won, like, 5 years in a row. Then there is the Super Boeans, who have, like a car that's also a mecha.
It's a mech. It just turns into a mech.
It has mechs, and it has boobs.
Yes. And each pilot is in one of the boobs.
Boobs, yes. Yeah. And, or how Todoroki and Miku have like a fucking like mole bot, where they both have to pedal in order like to activate the nitro. It's very interesting. Like the actual designs of the characters and the vehicles and like the way everything looks, it looks really, really nice and unique.
Yeah, by the way, Todoroki and Miki are actually named after the voice actors, Iki Todoroki and Tsunichiji Miki.
Oh, that's interesting.
They're actually supposed to be the voice actors themselves in the movie, playing themselves.
That's amazing.
Both of the leads in Japanese are voiced by singers. And the voiced by singers, at least in Japan, the Japanese cast is extremely star-studded. It's not a voice actor cast. It is a lot of live action actors in this. Yeah,
I was actually really impressed with the dub voice work.
All right, yeah, the dub is great. This is a hard movie to dub, because it's one of those movies where the lip flaps are like extremely fucking precise.
Mm-hmm.
The dub for this is great, particularly Patrick Seitz,
Seitz is great as JP,
and Michelle Ruff is Michonne. She is also great.
I knew I recognized her voice. I just had to look it up.
It's Rukia, dude.
Yeah.
I think one of my favorite performances though is Doug Holtz as the Secretary of Defense though. I think he's great. Same with fucking Liam O'Brien's in this too.
Liam O'Brien is Frisbee, yeah.
Yes.
And when you hear his voice, when you hear him, it's like, oh, that's Liam O'Brien. That's, like, you know that immediately it's him.
I love that.
It's like you take a bunch of rare gemstones and throw them into a blender.
And that's Liam O'Brien's voice.
And that's Liam O'Brien. What else do we want to talk about in terms of good stuff from the movie? Because
I'm pretty sure we've covered everything.
Yeah, let's talk about what doesn't necessarily work, which is
everything else.
Okay, let's go through this, shall we? Here we go. What the fuck is the backstory with JP and Sonoshi? That's never touched on. What happens with RoboWorld? What about the military man who turns into a kaiju to fight the baby kaiju?
What happened to the two kaijus?
This, What about those that were with the mob boss who also fucked off? What about the member of the RoboWorld army who was fighting with the two soldiers who was crying all the time? What happens with the Super Boeans on their planet? What is the planet the Super Boeans come from? I don't understand why this race is so dangerous, considering that the only reason why it's dangerous is because it's on RoboWorld.
It's because the military's fucking with it. That's the only reason why it's so dangerous.
Also, for a race to be this dangerous, there was a surprising lack of people fucking with each other, even though it was explicitly stated in the rules that you can fuck with each other.
Yeah, you can. You can just go all out. It's a free-for-all. You can craft weapons to your vehicle. You can take anyone out you so desire, and yet no one was going after each other.
Also, the only one who really was doing anything was fucking Machine Head.
And that's because he wanted to win. Also, while we're at it, how the fuck does the boost work? What is the difference between the gold nitro and the platinum nitro? Why does the platinum nitro give out so much power? Also, considering that the engine that Frisbee gets for this vehicle is supposed to take out all that power,
why does the car fucking explode?
Exploding? Because the engine's supposed to handle that. You had already hit two gold, and it cools down after a bit, so why the fuck, when you hit the platinum, does your car explode? Why does your car explode and nobody else's car explode when you hit the platinum nitro? Is it because their cars are made better? What is RoboWorld's deal? Why is the kaiju made? Why can they make people into kaijus? Why was it trapped in amber to begin with? Who are the people attacking it when it got broken out of the amber? Why do people hate RoboWorld? What's the deal with the moon? I don't know, and you never will.
Why is it that the RoboWorld military is so keen on obeying the law of the universe when they themselves are breaking it?
Because fascist dictatorships do that? I don't know.
What happened to everyone after the movie ends? Why does it just end as soon as the race ends? Why is there no epilogue? Why is there no conclusion to anything?
Because like the movie literally, by the way, just stops.
It just stops playing.
The movie just ends. Like, there is no...
Like, JP and Sonashi win the race, and they're like, oh, I love you. Oh, I love you too. Credits.
Oh, that's nice. But what's the cultural significance of the earring? Why does she not remember JP when he doesn't look different compared to back in the day?
Yeah,
was that race?
I don't get that either.
How old was she at that time, considering that she looked like a young child, and then she's a fully grown woman with like a super thin waist and massive boobs? How does that work? Why was she racing in the yellow line, but he wasn't? Why is he still allowed to race, even though he was caught for race fixing?
Well, no, he was given this is his second chance, a chance of redemption, Spencer.
Okay, why, when he's given the money after Frisbee blows up his vehicle, does he still have to worry about the mob? The money was supposed to be payment for like bail and all that, and it was supposed to be like a done deal after that. Then what is Frisbee's deal? Does he like being part of the mob? Is having guns pointed at him his kink? What's the old man's deal? How does he know JP and Frisbee? Why do they hate each other? Why does a pack of cigarettes cost all of your money? I don't know. And it's not even a full pack of cigarettes. It's only like four of them.
It's like it's already open. There's like four missing. It's like, hey, what the hell?
Okay, I'm done.
Okay, yeah, all right. This movie makes no goddamn sense. And the only reason it's a problem is because they spend so much time building things up. And then they just stop. Everything disappears. Nothing has a definitive conclusion. It just ends. So what's the fucking point?
It literally just ends. Like, there is no point to any of this. It's like, let's say they did build it up, I would say that maybe there was if they did build it up, I would say, okay. And if they did wrap it up, I'd be like, okay, that's better. But they don't do that?
No.
Like,
Like, they build up the red line, they build up the threat of the RoboWorld military, they build up all of these illegal things that they're doing that they're trying to hide from the public, and then it just ends. So, you don't know...
It just ends.
You don't know what happens to any of the racers after the race ends. You don't know what happens to the RoboWorld military, whether they get caught, whether they get disbanded. You don't know what happens with the mob and what happens with Frisbee if he gets out of it. Like, nothing has a conclusion.
Is he rubbing on his gums? Is it space cocaine? Are we
pretty
real?
Sure it is.
I don't even know what it is. Like, what is it? I don't know. Like, fucking...
It's just...
Fuck it.
And literally, the only reason it's a problem is because they spend so much time in the second act is all build-up.
Yeah.
And then nothing happens after that. It's just the race happens, the race ends. See ya never.
Have fun.
See ya never.
Have fun. Now, like, wait.
I said this to Matt, like, if they had spent maybe 10, 15 extra minutes at the end with a proper epilogue that explained what happened after the race and gave everything a satisfying conclusion, okay, that would have been fine. But they didn't. And I don't know why they didn't. If there was scripting issues, if it was a budgetary thing, they ran out of money. I have no idea.
Considering, here's the thing about the budget for this movie. The movie went $25 million over budget.
So they ran out of money. Dollars. Okay. That makes sense.
And the movie was in production for 10. All I know is that apparently that if Takeshi Koike said that if he wanted to, he would have just kept going. They had to stop at some point.
So then they had to cut a lot out, I'm assuming.
I don't know how much, because the production of this movie is mostly just kind of like outside of the whole... handmade drawing, and like the fact that it was only in production for so long. All we know is that it was all hand drawn and it took a long time and it was over budget. That's all we know. They've kept a lot of production under wraps, probably because it probably was a shitstorm.
Oh, I hope so.
Probably.
And it's probably one of those things where it's just like it was a complete and utter shit show. So they're just like, well, this is never getting out. So, but in any case, I think we're ready for final scores here.
Yeah, it seems about right.
All right. I'll start with Spencer. Spencer, what do you give Redline?
Redline gets the most solid I've ever given an anime on this podcast. The most solid 9 out of 10 I've ever given an anime. This anime movie is amazing. And if you haven't already seen it, I got it on Blu-ray for like $15.
It's like legit, you can buy it online for like $15-$20. It's not expensive at all.
It's not expensive. It's worth it. I can tell you to it on 5x1 surround sound with my noise canceling headphones was amazing sounding. So that's definitely the proper way. I'll probably watch it in Japanese once just to get that through as well. But no, this is genuinely solid. It's solid all around except for the multiple plot points that could have been resolved by a second movie, but never did happen.
Honestly, it could have been resolved with an epilogue. Give it an extra scene. Like, that's all you needed.
15 minutes, all you need.
Yeah, all you needed was like to say, hey, give us more movie. Shane, what do you give it?
I agree with Spencer. I'm giving it an extremely solid 9 out of 10. It is an animation spectacle, the likes of which you will very rarely see. But if it had just taken a little bit extra time to wrap up all those plot points, it probably would have been a perfect 10. But unfortunately, it didn't. So, easy 9.
Mm-hmm. I also give it a 9 out of 10. It is an excellent feature of animation, arguably groundbreaking in animation terms. It is absolutely one of the most visually stunning things you will ever see. And if you and if you haven't seen it yet, watch it on the biggest screen possible with the best sound possible. It is absolutely fucking worth it. It's honestly very, very impressive. It's impressive to look at from pretty much every angle. So, in that case, I think we're ready to move on to what's going to be our next featured anime of the podcast. And if you guys don't know how this works, we switch between a choice on us and the randomizer. Redline was after a very shitty randomizer.
Yeah.
So now it's time for our picks, and it is Shane's turn to pick. I know what Shane's picking, unless he changed it last minute on me like he's done before, but I don't think he did.
Oh, I could have.
I do not know what he's picking, actually, so I'm excited.
Oh, was that my cue?
Yeah, that was your cue.
Okay. Because Matt wasn't like, Shane, what did you pick? I heard nothing.
My internet is pretty much fucking up over here right now, so.
And I'm at like 2% battery, so.
Alright, well, wrap this up. So.
Oh, shit.
So,
we're good.
For my pick, that's why you were fiddling around. I was wondering.
Yeah, because I was trying to get my laptop working.
Okay, well, for my pick for next podcast, I picked a show that I've wanted to talk about for a while now. Even with all the new additions over the last year, it still consistently stayed in my top 10 list. So next time, we're going to be watching the action sci-fi mecha show from Gainax, Gurren Lagann.
Oh!
We're finally going to be watching
Gurren. Yes, I knew it.
No, I didn't change it last minute, you bitch.
I'm just making, you've done it before, so I'm just...
Usually with metas, but yeah, we're watching Gurren next time, so get ready.
Awesome.
Yeah, we're watching Gurren. I'm very excited. I haven't seen Gurren. It's time for me to rewatch Gurren, because the last time I watched Gurren was like 5 years ago. So so it's time to rewatch Gurren Lagann. I'm your host, Matt, aka Legionix. You can find me on Twitter. At CatStan account, also known as at Legion Rex, where you can find my shitty opinions on pretty much everything. With me, I also have my co-host Shane, aka the Bearded One. You can find him on Twitter at Bearded Gaming Network. You can also find him on YouTube at Bearded Gaming Network, where he has a multitude of videos from unboxings, let's plays, gameplay videos, and a bunch of other stuff. So go check him out. With me, I also have my co-host Spencer. You can go find him on Twitter at Beery Burton with two E's.
Two E's.
So if you want to go and follow him, go do that. And I think we're pretty much done here. So I think we'll see you. And I think we'll see you all next time for Gurren Lagann.
Gurren Lagann.
A Tengentapa Gurren Lagann.
My drill is the drill that will pierce the heavens.
Maybe we'll get some super galaxy Gurren Lagann.
Maybe we'll get some anti-spirals.
Or maybe that one really cool, the coolest form that was only in the movie that wasn't in the show.
Oh, the big one. Yeah. I need to watch the movie.
Yeah, I might watch the movie actually for this rewatch.
Just letting you know, the movie is... not on any legal... Is it on any? I don't believe
it
is on
legal
service, and there is no dub for it.
That's what I figured.
They never dubbed it, and it's not on any legal streaming service. It is also... They're like half recap,
half new remake. Stuff.
The half recap, half completely new telling, half complete remake. So, like...
They're weird.
Yeah, they're weird. They're definitely worth watching though, because they're really good. We'll see you all next time for Tengen Toppa Gurren Lagann.
It's gonna be hype. Thank you for listening to The Gap. If you like what you've seen, you can subscribe to The Gap Podcast YouTube channel to get the latest podcasts as they go live. Be sure to like and comment and let us know what you guys think of the show. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next week. Go, get that go.